All right, so start off with a few stories here. The first one, I guess, really just to show my age. Anyone ever been to the Time to Escape events? I think there's one in Atlanta, there's one in Birmingham. My son, who's 16, he went to one when he was going to a basketball tournament. And they put you in this room, and you have to find ways to get out. And he said that they were in this room, and it was a bunch of 16-year-olds, and they were trying to get a clue to get to the next stage, and the clue was on a cassette tape. So there was like the old boom box there, you put the cassette tape in and play it. Well, no one could figure out how to put the cassette tape in, because now everything's an MP3 player and things of that nature. So they had to actually call someone to find out, you know, a way to get the cassette in there. And that really lends to the topic of the conversation today around what's legacy. And there's a few pictures up here. Of course, the top one is a typewriter. We can see how that's just evolved over the years. The bottom one with the little floppy drives there, that was interesting. That I found an article from the Federal Reserve where they were actually using floppy drives back in 2014 still, transferring data. So, and then the last one, the picture on my far right, is a picture of a miner. And I live in a mining community, and my wife's grandfather, he was a miner his whole life. And way back when he first started mining, they used to have canaries in the mines. And the canary would tell the miners if they're in any trouble with the air, because gas is a real big problem down there. You can see over time how all these things have evolved, which lends to the definition here. Legacy is an old method, technology, system, or program that is outdated or in need of being replaced. So we'll talk about that throughout the presentation. So to start off, we can talk about, you know, why companies consider changing a legacy system. The first bullet point up here is probably the most dangerous one, right? The system's working fine. Don't touch it, right? It's working okay. A story that we're dealing with now in our local church, where, you know, people use or transfer funds differently. You know, traditionally a church is, you pay with a check or money. You know, churches are now evolving to where people can pay via electronic transfer, things of that nature. So it's really determining, you know, if we're going to change, if we're going to move into that area of accepting that type of payment. Right now, you know, in that world, the payments work fine, but in order to help people, in order to open that method up, we need to actually adapt to it. Same thing in our businesses today. There are probably systems that are working fine. They're doing things, however, it's not enabling us to move forward with other applications for our clients, new services, new offers, etc. Another reason is that there could be large costs associated with rewriting or designing. You had this application that you built way back when. It seemed like in the printing industry there is a very high tenure. So when you start in the in the industry, your average years of tenure with a company can be very high. So the knowledge base is a lot between those walls you have at your organization. So understanding how the system was designed, it could be very costly in redesigning or repurposing. Retraining, culture problems, right? You know, having a culture that, excuse me, that doesn't accept change very well, or there is a sort of a barrier to accepting a new system or a new technology. So retraining can always be an issue. Client requirements. Clients change over the years, right? We've talked about already, Matt and the others have already spoken about some things where our clients are needing different services or various services, new services, to meet the needs of their consumers. The system is not well understood. So understanding that we built this system years ago, it's worked over time, we've made some changes as we've went along to make things work, but really the code behind the scenes, no one truly understands it. So it's sitting there, it's doing the job, it's working well, but it's not allowing us to expand. The user expects the system can easily be replaced when necessary. That's another one that can be very dangerous, right? Thinking that we can go on and on and on to a certain point, then say, okay, we're ready to switch. But there's a lot of things to consider when we look at that. There's a lot of not only internal but external items, things to plan for, you know, regression testing, all that good stuff. New systems may have more functions that are not needed. Jennifer Matt, I'm not sure if you follow her, but Jennifer Matt did a really good article a while back talking about web-to-print solutions, and she mentioned about there can be a feature overload where you have this really cool web-to-print solution. It has all these bells and whistles, but the end user may only use two or three pieces of it. I mean, there's just an overwhelming amount of functions out there that they just don't use. So here are just some reasons why a company or an organization may consider keeping a legacy system. That can lead us into these challenges or the solutions that are in place. So the challenges that we face as a solution provider. Trends in consumer spending. That is a very big driver in our industry, right? The more that the consumer has available to spend, the more they have the opportunity to make more purchases, to, you know, in the market, the vertical that we live in, they can have more bills, statements, notices that go out. So the more that the consumer has available, that can drive that change or force that change. State of the global economy. One thing that in other areas that I've seen in writings and columns where there is a big emphasis on the consumer's confidence, you know, how well are they, you know, how much confidence do they have in the economy, you know, and that's affecting the global economies. The more, of course, the more money that they have available, the more the global economy will improve. New technology and the speed of change. We know that technology is changing at a very rapid rate. Went ahead there. At a very rapid rate, and technology will continue to evolve. We know that the solutions we have today, they're going to get better, they're going to improve, and so we're going to need to be in a position to evolve on those, to move to the next version, the next application, etc. Technology will never slow down because we're going to be adapted to the consumer base that we have. Increasing number of client requirements. In the industry that I live in, we know that just with regulations alone, that client requirements can be numerous. Clients are essentially all the same. They, you know, they want something printed. They want a communication out there. They want to be able to get this information, present it to the consumer. But the way they go about it can be very different. Same data file, you know, same wanting to produce this document, but the rules, the logic behind it can be very, very different. What we're seeing just in the regulation side is that those client requirements are increasing at a very, very fast rate. Now we know that there's been a lot of talk I've seen in different columns and such about, you know, the regulations around Dodd-Frank and a few others, you know, what the emphasis there is. So we'll see how this year goes and other in the future years to see how that's going to impact that sort of vertical. Consumer expectations. Matt and Andy did a really good job of sort of laying the foundation for this. There's many touch points that a consumer can get their information on. In the mail, web, phone, all these different touch points, and they're expecting that. They're, especially as we get into different generations, that it's going to become more and more of just a status quo, right? To be able to provide that information in the device that the consumer wants. That's becoming more of a demand. Digital, well, of course, that is a really big driver in that. We know that, I'll take my son as an example. When he couldn't use that cassette player, he could easily use his phone to Google it to figure out, you know, once he found out what it was, he could Google it to get instructions on it. So we know digital is a very big factor on the younger generation, generations that are coming into more of a consumer mode. So that'll be very important. I've already touched on compliance and regulations, but just to emphasize it again, because I guess it's something that I just see a lot of in the clients that I work with, the applications that I support, those are these have such an impact as a service provider, because our clients are coming to us with a very urgent, specific need, right? I have this New York disclaimer that has changed. I need to be able to put it in the document and have it to the consumer by X date. And if I don't, then there are penalties to pay. There's all types of things that can happen. So we know that that plays a very big part, poses a very big challenge to the solutions that we can have. So just to reemphasize again on regulations, the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau is one that made some headlines a while back, and they are still making headlines after looking at a few articles on their recent verdicts or judgments that have come down. What I have on the screen here is just a snippet of some of the judgments that they've passed down. 45 public enforcement actions between April 1st, 2014 and March 31st, 2015. $2 million for misrepresentation and advertisements. Think about all the ads that we produce for our clients. So you can see there's a very direct need to make sure that everything is correct when it goes out. $2 million for violation of the Consumer Financial Protection Act of 2010. So somewhere in that big, long, lengthy regulation, there was something that was missed, something that wasn't checked off, something that wasn't followed through with, so that resulted in that enforcement action. $418 million of violations of homeowner protection. There again, all these things have an impact to our clients. So whenever these regulations come out, whenever new ones are in the market, we have to have the tools to be able to handle that, right? We have to have the tools to be able to provide our clients with the ability to make these changes effectively, to be able to go in and quickly make the change and go in and audit the change, etc. Vendor management, I'm sorry, we've already discussed that regulations are changing at a very fast rate. We'll see how the next few years progress to see how that changes, or if it slows down or increases. Just looking at what's happened over the past, until the economy gets into an upward swing, there may be more regulations to handle that, but that's just my opinion. Vendor management, that's a huge one, especially for the industry that I'm in. Our clients not only have to worry about what they do, but they have to worry about what we do as well. They have to make sure that what we do is within the parameters that need to be in order to provide this communication to their consumers. A lot of oversight, as I'm sure most of you are aware, it's becoming more complex, more granular as time goes on. The questionnaires that I get can be very, very lengthy in what they're asking for, the information that they need. So there again, the solutions we have in place has a direct impact in this. Think of a legacy system that you may have that it was good 10 years ago, but because it being in place 10 years ago, it may not meet some of the security and compliance requirements that are in place today. So we have to be able to handle that. Complex data. I mentioned earlier that clients are really, they're the same. They have this need. They want to get this communication out, but the data file they have, it may even be the same for multiple clients, but the way they use the data may be differently. Let's say that client A is producing a statement and they're using four or five different values to come up with the payment due. And client B is having the same data file, but they're using different variations of that of the data to come up with the payment due. So same data file, same general purpose, but the way the data is being used can be different, can be very complex. There again, just speaking to the industry that I work in, we receive files from the client, and they'll come to us and say, we have information here, but there are some things that are missing that we need lodging in place to handle. We need to be able to create a mechanism to generate a message or a new value. There again, having a solution in place to be able to handle that is very critical. Your legacy system that was probably in place, years ago could handle that normal file coming in, simple data logic, but now that things have evolved, we need a system in place that can handle it more complex. Critical communications. There again, the industry that that I live in, the clients that I work with, they have this need for a critical communication. It's something that the consumer is required to have. Something, it could be a notice, it could be a letter, it could be something that our client is required to send out because of regulation. So these things have, they're very near and dear to our client's heart, not only because of just the message that's going out, but also because of the regulations that are behind it. So that leaves us with any, you know, a decision to be made at the end of the day. You know, are you going to keep your legacy system, or are you going to go to a new system, a new method of doing it? Like I said, the legacy system, when it was first put in place, it could handle the data very well. You could have all the bells and whistles that at that time was in place. You might even been maintaining it over the course of years. And we know with maintaining your own system can come into other aspects of, you know, more people, more costs, etc. Then you have this new solution. You have a solution in place that has been made to handle these complex data solutions or complex data requirements, the ability to make changes faster, the ability to handle multi-channel output. So not only creating a method for print, but also creating a method for electronic delivery as well. And this all starts with a foundation. Very early on in my career, I had some very, very smart people around me that sort of mentored me throughout the way. And this is one thing that I've definitely picked up along the way, is that there are three things that has to be in place. People, process, and technology. Those are things that you will continually evolve on. I don't think you'll ever get to a point where you're going to come to the end, right, and say you have everything perfectly. This is something that you're going to continually to build upon. We can talk first about people, the knowledge that people have. One thing about the printing industry that I've always found sort of appealing is that everyone that works in a printing industry is also a consumer, right? Because you're getting this information in the mail, you're getting some type of communication, so you know how that impacts you. You make up the market, so you have a knowledge just based it from that perspective. When you talk about the various silos within a print service provider, you can have, of course, the programming area, the development, marketing, etc. All these things require some very specific knowledge in order to be able to handle the client needs, to be able to understand what the system needs to be able to do in order to create this communication. There also has to be a culture of change. And that's something that we probably all faced at one time, right? Where we have just a new way of doing things, and we have to change the status quo. We have to change the way our normal process is going in order to be able to better serve our clients. So that requires a change in culture. People have to be able to accept change, and that's something that can be hard at times. I know as a parent, my son doesn't like change. He likes his pattern. He likes his routine. But that's something that we have to evolve into. Processes. Thank you. Processes, workflow. Workflow is something that I believe, as all the other variables change, your workflow will improve as well. It will have to adapt to all the things that are coming in from the market. We can take a look at the complex data. Being able to take a legacy application, repurpose it, but also understanding the same elements that are coming in, but also adding two new elements to drive a better communication. Complement technology. This is something that, as a print service provider, I know that I can't do everything that my customer wants. So I know that there are certain things I'm going to have to rely on vendors to help out with. I'm going to have to leverage their expertise. I'm going to have to get an understanding of what they can help out with. This is that complement technology. This is where we're going to do something. This technology is going to come in and it's going to enhance it. It's going to improve upon it. Analytics is one thing, right? We all know about analytics. We know that whenever we send an email out, that there is a bunch of analytics that's captured. Being able to track that, report on that, provide that to clients is very critical. And the last one is technology. And a few things that we've talked about already today is the CCM model. This is that platform, right? This is that universal application that's going to allow you to create these communications, maintain these communications, and position them in a manner in which you can send these communications out on various platforms. The ability to maintain the CCM platform is very critical, right? So going back to the people, making sure they understand how the system works, making sure that we are using all the system. How many systems do we have in our organization today that we may only use 20% of it? You know, we have to get better at using the full complement of what the technology offers. Excuse me for one second. Let me take a... And the last one is the ability to advance as the market changes. And there again, we know that the market, as I've seen it for the past few years and looked at projections, it's not going to slow down, it's not going to change. New requirements will come in, technology will change, new ways consumers will get information is going to change. The things that I once thought before we wouldn't adapt, we're adapting to. So that's always going to put us in a position where our technology has to be able to adapt to that. And like I said before, this is an ongoing process. This is something that we never get to that ending point. So just looking at the evaluation of a CCM solution, just go through sort of a process that I've been through, just understanding, you know, looking at the various systems that are out there. So some things we have to consider. The one is stability, right? The CCM platform is going to be a core part, as a print service provider, a core part of our business. We make sure that we choose a solution that's very stable, that has the ability to create, you know, new versions, you know, hot fixes, etc., as needs require. And that leads into the next one, which is a roadmap. Being able to understand what's down the road. So right now we know that we're delivering to four different applications. We want to make sure that the roadmap is going to evolve in the future to handle more, that type of scenario. Roadmaps are very critical to understand not only where you stand today, but also where your technology partner will help you in the future. So today we all know that there are probably gaps in our offerings. Understanding the technology, the vendors they work with, will help us shrink those gaps as time goes on. And like I've sort of mentioned all throughout this presentation, it seems, is the ability to handle complex data. And there again, just going back to what I've been involved in, the clients that I work with, I've seen data change dramatically over the course of the past few years. We know that data will be even more complex. I remember a time when years ago, when I first started, we used to create the file, create the batch, and print everything as one person. Now that's changed over time, but back then it was one type of file layout, primarily. Now we're getting supplemental files. We're getting main data file, then supplemental files to handle different aspects of the communication. The ability to repurpose legacy applications. So taking that document we're producing today, taking the program that's driving it, sort of breaking that apart, looking back at all the changes that have been made, taking that information and then applying it in this new system so we can easily migrate, right? So we can easily move forward with this new application. And that's one that takes time, right? Because we know that with any legacy system, you're putting time and effort into it, you're building things out, you're creating these communications. And so with all that, you're creating this output that has been built on a legacy application, which is just, you know, could be years and years worth of information. So taking that output, taking that legacy application and repurposing for this new platform. Scalability. Scalability is one that probably can never be underestimated, because you don't want to get into the same situation that you may find yourself in today. With a legacy application, one of the things that you're thinking about to move to a new platform is the ability to not scale. Well, you definitely will make sure that whenever you implement a new platform that has the ability to scale. You know, you want your technology, your partners to grow as you grow, that you want to be in a position where you can offer more to your clients. Downstream workflow impacts. Think about in just a normal day activity where we get a file from a client, we process that file, we create the jobs and manufacturing pieces to it, it goes to the manufacturing floor, it's printed, it gets sent to an inserter, it's inserted, and then it goes onto the mail stream. So when we look at that, we have to think about the whole workflow, we have to think about the whole picture. We have to make sure that if we implement something here, that it's not going to negatively infect something downstream. We want to make sure that we improve the overall process and not, you know, putting limitations on it in the long run. The ability to penetrate additional markets and verticals. So as a marketer, this is something that definitely want to look into, right, when we're evaluating something. We will know that we do something very well for one vertical, but we want to make sure that if we get an opportunity to look at another vertical, that our technology stack will help us penetrate that market. From the surface, it seems very simplistic that, you know, all companies want some type of communication going out. However, the way those are created, the regulations behind the creation of the documents, the storage, all these things could come into play, which all has to be considered when we look at the platforms that we're choosing. End user functions. I mentioned earlier about Jennifer Madden, the article she wrote about web-to-print solutions. The thing about CCM that I find, you know, kind of intriguing is that, you know, I want one that has tons of functions and features, and because as an end user, I can, as a service provider, I can turn those things off and on as needed. If I don't have a client that really needs all these functions and features, I can use what's in place and have these sort of, you know, waiting in the wings, so to speak, whenever a new client comes on. However, that does go back to the people, the culture aspect of it, and making sure that everyone knows the full complement of the solution. Because there again, we don't want to get a solution that we only use, you know, 10-20% of. Meet growing client expectations. There again, as our clients grow, we need to grow with them. We need to be that trusted partner that we've heard earlier today. We need to be able to have a stable platform, have the ability to scale as they scale, have the ability to meet their growing needs. So some key elements that I'll kind of leave you with, and I know I'm standing between you and lunch, so I don't have a very long presentation here. I just want to talk about a few stories, so to speak. But some key elements to about this is that strong personalization. We've already heard this today. The clients that I work with, we get all this massive amount of information in these data files. And in these data files, we're using bits and pieces of it to create these communications. As time goes on, I feel that there will be even more and more of that information being used to create these type of communications, whether it's a compliance vehicle that's going out, so a compliance notice or letter, to a statement, to a marketing brochure, whatever the case may be. I think this will evolve as time goes on. And sort of a blurb here that I got, return on investment improves when a worker can retrieve a document, enter data, or make selections that personalize the output. So getting that very robust legacy system that we have today, getting it and creating a sort of a lot version of it to be able to allow an end user to make updates to it, to make corrections, to approve, that's very critical, because that's going to create that a stronger personalized output. Because we know, just as a consumer, that the easier something is to do, the more apt you're going to do it, right? So if you have a website that, I guess, kind of the true blue thing, if it requires you to enter the last 20 passwords, then, you know, you may be apt not to go to that website as much. The more convenient it is, the more apt you'll do it, which will improve that personalization. Products moving to a multi-channel conversion platform. We've already talked about it today, that the data that we receive And the communication that's going out, whether it's email, SMS, whatever the case may be, is being used from that core data file. So having a platform in place that can take that data file and use it to handle all those communications will just improve the overall workflow, the overall streamlining of processes. And engaging statements, we just heard about this. Being able to take that static PDF and bring it to life, being able to engage the consumer at a higher level, be able to take that document and add various elements to it, but make it come to life so the consumer can really engage. And the last thing on here is vendor support. That's something that I probably can't advocate too much of, is really start a conversation with your vendors, with your partners, to really understand what is out there, what their strengths are, what the opportunities are to grow. Because there again, like I said earlier, we're a print service provider, we're gonna print, do things. What can they do to help us in those areas to really grow our business? To go along with some key elements here, the ease to maintain documents. So thinking about that platform, thinking about the ability to make changes, taking that legacy application, repurposing it so it's easier to maintain. Because with any new platform, you don't want to take what you currently have today, which let's say you have 100 different templates. You don't want to take those 100 templates and transform them to a new platform where you're just going to have to maintain 100 templates. You want to be able to maximize that process. You want to be able to improve that process. So having a platform that enables a way to easier maintain documents. And there again, just going back to the regulations piece, because of the way regulations come out, because of the way clients have to approach these regulations, there may be cases where there are hundreds and hundreds of different templates. So being able to maintain those is very critical. One thing we heard just a few minutes ago is open the maintenance of those documents up to the client. Being able to allow the client, the end user, the ability to make that critical New York disclaimer change, change that period or change the telephone number, whatever the case may be. Putting that in the hands of them so they can easily maintain that is very critical. Provide a means for more business side control. When you think about the legacy system that you have in place, it was probably built for a specific purpose. When you move to a new platform, you're opening up the opportunity. You're opening up the ability to look at other areas of your business that maybe you didn't have that much control. So now you can add more control to it. Direct lines into the business to drive change. And there again, I'll just reemphasize partnerships. Being able to leverage the partners that you have in place, because you have your core competency, which is printing, getting the communication out. You want to leverage partnerships to fill in the gaps where those offerings may be. And looking at weighing the options, performance and scalability, making sure that you have X amount of data you're producing a day. You want to make sure that you can produce that. That's sort of the minimal viable product, right? What you do today is the bare minimum, but looking in the future, you want to be able to add to that to be able to scale. Integration capabilities, looking at the platform that you have today and maybe the missing links. So maybe the legacy platform that you have, it doesn't speak to system A or system B. The new platform, making sure it can integrate with that to fill in those gaps where any efficiencies may be. Omnichannel support, something that we've talked about throughout the day, is creating the document, being able to publish it from this one platform, going to many channels based on the consumer's preference. Feature and functionality. Like to understand what's presently in the application and like to understand what's in the future. So that roadmap, understanding where the technology is going. What is the vendor seeing in their view from the market? I know what I see from the market, from a print service provider in a specific vertical, but what are they seeing? What challenges are other verticals seeing? What are they doing to overcome that? So what's the feature and functionality today versus what will be in the future, and why is it going into that? Is it, we want to make sure that there is a real core need, a real good fix to a challenge or a problem. And vendor support, you know, this is going beyond just talking with them in the partnership, but hey, if we're having trouble getting, you know, getting from point A to point B, we want to make sure that we can engage a vendor to help us out in that transition, be able to move us, help guide us, help give us, you know, best practices, all those key elements there. And the results should be, you know, these are the things that I would view as, you know, as the finish line. Migrate legacy applications. You definitely don't want to maintain two systems, right? You want to make sure that you move everything to one core platform, be able to easily control it. You know, we heard earlier, I think it might have been Andy that was speaking, where there was one client who was working with that had 11 different systems. You know, want to make sure that you can easily maintain these applications. You know, see a reduction in time to create communications. We know that there's, you know, the clients that I work with, and the clients in industry, there's always a rush, right? There's always a need. There's always a desire to get this communication to their consumer. Having this platform positioned so it can help reduce that time. You know, make sure that the process is seamless where there's no bottlenecks along the way. And of course, cost savings. That, you know, that makes everybody happy, right? When there's ability to improve, to reduce the cost over the course, over the span of the organization. Looking at retiring certain applications, looking at repurposing, maybe some the way things are done internally, you know, improving workflows. This all can result in an outcome or result in the move to a different platform. An increase in revenue, right? You're doing your job better. You're doing your job more efficiently. You know, that's definitely a goal. That's definitely a result you want to see. You don't want to go into a situation where you're taking more time to manage an application, taking more time or taking more resources to do it. More importantly, you want to make sure that you improve that revenue. And you won't get any of the other two unless you do the next one, which is improve customer satisfaction. You know, making sure that, you know, what you're doing aligns with the clients. And unfortunately, you get to hear from me twice today. So later on, I'll be doing a presentation and really talking about that. You want to make sure that what you're doing internally is, you know, objectively meeting the need of the client today, but also looking ahead to the future, talking about, you know, just like as we speak with roadmaps with our technology partners, understanding where the roads are for our clients as well. And more volume, right? Having a better, more stable, more flexible, the ability to integrate a solution should lead to more volume, right? Should lead us to the ability to handle more applications, handle more work so we can get a better throughput. Automation and streamline process. Anywhere where there is a manual process in place, you know, you want to make sure we can try to eliminate that. We want to make sure that we move to a more of an automation type environment. This CCM solution can definitely help in that area. Some of the things that we've seen is the ability to handle controls from different environments and be able to process things. So creating a streamlined process is very important. And provide a means to expand. There again, looking beyond that vertical that you sit in today, looking at all the other clients that may be out there to see how the solution can bring benefits to them. And as mentioned, you know, we're a GMC client, and just some of the things that GMC offers, you know, Inspire Designer, that repurpose that legacy output, taking that that legacy composition, moving it to a more modern output design. Color management is another piece of it. We know that color is becoming more and more important in our clients' minds. That goes along with personalization, which can lead to data handling. How we're taking that data in, how we're repurposing it, how we're leveraging what we could be missing in the legacy application to what we're doing now in the new platform. Interactive. This is that the ability to make changes through a GUI type scenario. So not having a programmer there, but having someone that just understands what needs to be changed in the template. This interactive solution can do that. And lastly, dynamic communications. This is that engaging output. This is taking that static PDF and bringing it to life. And these are all solutions that GMC has information on. Just want to mention them here because they directly tie to the information that I presented earlier. So understanding how to, you know, improve upon a legacy application, you know, creating a platform or having a platform that can meet the ever-growing demands of a client, you know, making changes faster, interactive, being able to provide an environment where if there's a simple phone number change or if there's a simple disclaimer change in a paragraph, have a solution that can enable an end user to go in and make that change. And then dynamic communications, creating that engaging output. So moving from a PDF to more of an engaging output. And with that being said, I'll stop and see if there are any questions or comments.
I have a question.
Sure.
You talked a lot about roadmap.
Yes, sir.
And the importance of roadmap. And, you know, you got to understand where you're at, what technology's out there, what might be coming down the pike, and in some cases, assume the evolution of the technology. How does a company kind of wrap their arms? Because that road never ends. How does a company kind of wrap their arms around? How does NCP do that?
I'm going to give a plug for Xploration and say that this environment here gave me a good mechanism to understand what's available in the market. You know, talking to peers, and then there's things like Graph and other just industry trade shows that gives the wealth of knowledge that you need to understand what's in the marketplace. That's
great.
For me, yeah. Yes, sir.
About the legacy systems and evaluating and converting things over. Do you have a lot of ongoing jobs that you were the legacy that you convert everything, or do you pick and choose what to convert? Does anything stay, or do you convert 100%?
I would say, but now this is my perspective. Ideally, I'd want everything moved.
Right.
Because, of course, you can just improve your costs or improve your revenue, lower your costs. However, if there are things that are really profitable that, you know, you can run on that legacy application and not risk losing it, then maybe that's something you choose to keep on a legacy
or
system.
Or if it's so small that it's not cost-effective, yeah. Did you have any of that, or did you, everything was big enough to move no matter
what? This is an ongoing process for us,
right.
Yeah.
So you're still...
We're still, yeah. Any other questions? Well, thank you for your time. I appreciate it.